We are taking the operating system concepts, and this is based on the Silvashaz Galvin book, Operating System Concepts on Operating System. So this is the first one, introduction. What is an operating system? Which has many definition, which has many work. So this is actually a program itself. The way you write a program to swap values or to Fibonacci or to factorial, just like this is a program. And that is, this program is managing the computer hardware. And it is the basis, it is the, you can say, the underlying layer for all the application programs. This is you and this is your hardware. So it is an interface between you and hardware. And it provides an environment. There is an environment it is going to provide such that the programs, all the programs can work properly, efficiently and in harmony. So what is the objective of our discussion is, we want to give you the major components of operating system and to describe the basic organization what the computer means. So what operating system does do, or it has various tasks. So computer system can be divided into hardware, into operating system, into application program, into users. So the first thing is hardware, that is pure electronics. So it provides the basic computing resources like CPU, memory and input or output devices. Then you have operating systems. So operating system is the most important part after your hardware and your programs. That is, it controls and coordinates the use of hardware because you have various applications and users. So how to coordinate, control and efficiently use the hardware? This is what is done by operating system. Then we have application programs. Application programs are general purpose program that you use in daily life, like word processor, compilers, your web browser like Chrome, Safari, etc. Database management system like Oracle, SQL Server, and video games, of course. Anything, you know, of your choice. Then, of course, you, users. Because without you, there is no use of any computer operating system. So people, machine which are dependent on machine, and there are other computers which are dependent. So all these work. Or first of all, we'll see the components and then I'll tell you what exactly they do. So hardware is, you know, anything which you can touch, right? You can feel. That is CPU, memory, input output devices, provide the VSI. They are the basic computing resources for the system. And when you talk about an application system, these are for your use. That means it is going to solve your purpose. The operating system, on the other hand, it is going to control the hardware and all the coordination between various applications, because there can be so many applications running, you know. You don't know even that, you know, your system may be running various applications on the background. If you open the task manager, you'll see there are various processes which are going on, which you have not started. So all these coordination, controlling, working, non-working, operating system does that, sees that. So, you know, you can view the computer system as three parts: hardware, software and data. So operating system is that thing, or it provides you a means so that the resources, when you are using, when the computer system is in operation, these are used properly. So there are two views of operating system. First of all, your view means how we view, how an individual will view the operating system. And there is another view, which is system view. How the system is going to view as the operating system. This is your view, and computer system means, you can say hardware view, you can say like that. So user view is what? User view actually varies according to what interface you are using. Some operating systems, they are just designed for ease of use. Not much performance, not much you know, effort is paid for the resource allocation. For if you are single user, for you, this is more than enough. But some operating system, they are designed to maximize the resource utilization and see that the CPU time, memory and input output, they are used efficiently. And no individual user can take more than his time or share. So these are multi-user systems. And you know, the terminals can be connected to your mainframes and the mini computers. Here the user is going to share information and data. In some cases, user sit at workstation, which may be connected to some network or other workstation or servers. So these systems, they have dedicated resource like networking and servers. Now, here this operating system is compromising basically or exploiting the individual usability and resource utilization. Then what is the system view? You have seen just the user view. What is the system view as far as operating system is concerned? The program that is most intimately involved with the hardware is what? Your operating system. And this operating system is a resource allocator. It is going to solve various purpose, you know, CPU time, memory space, file storage space, input output devices, and there are so many things we are going to talk about. So operating system, they act as manager. They are manager of the resources, right? And you can have a different view of OS, which emphasizes that the need of control to various input output devices and user program. So operating system can be termed as a control program, and a control program which manages your programs, because there will be errors, there will be some improper use. So who is going to manage all this? Operating system. So for input output devices, it is also concerned with the operation and control of these input output devices. This is the system view. So how to define operating system? The best is, it is an interface between a user and the hardware. The simplest definition is this. So there is no real definition of operating system as such. The goal of operating system is just to execute program and to solve your purpose. And when you are solving your issues, then there has to be someone who is there, you know. So computer hardware is constructed towards this goal only, because you ought to have an operating system somewhere if you are using it, and maybe very small, but there has to be someone, because this hardware cannot do everything alone. It needs some software to be there to make it happen. And operating system, there are certain programs which would require common operation. Say you need to control input output, you need to control the resource utilization. So these common function of this controlling and allocating resources, if they are brought together in one piece of software, we call it as the OS, operating system. So what is the definition? The operating system is that program which is running all the time on the computer, which is somewhere called as kernel also. So in this kernel, there are two other types of program which are running: system program and application program. So these are associated with the operating system, this system program, but they are not part of kernel. They are not part of kernel. And how about application programs? This include all programs. They are not associated with the operation of the system. This is just to solve your purpose, like the word processor, like the tallies, like the, you know, so video games. Let us see the computer system organization, because in order to understand operating system, it becomes very important for us to know the computer organization. So computer system operation is that we can have one or more CPU, the device controllers. They may connect through the common bus. They provide us the shared memory, and you can have concurrent execution of CPUs also. And there are various devices which are competing that I should get memory cycle, I should get memory cycle. Like this, you have, this is a simple form. You have CPU, disk controller, USB controller, graphics adapter, you have a memory. So there has to be something to interface them all. So in computer system operation, how does it operate? When you start a computer, you need some program to boot it. This initial program is known as bootstrap program. And this is very small. This is stored in this read-only memory and EEPROM. And this is known as firmware, because it is formed. It is not software, but it is formed in your computer. When you boot your computer, you may see HP and Dell coming. This is all coming from the ROM. And it will initialize. First of all, it will initiate the things, and then it must know how to load the operating system, because bootstrap program, once it has checked all the things are fine, then it will load the operating system to the memory, right? In the memory, we are talking about main memory. And how does the operating system know? Everything is dependent on interrupt. So an event, which is signaled by the interrupt, it may be hardware, it may be software. So this hardware trigger, this is an interrupt by sending a signal to the CPU. So CPU understand, okay, some signal I have got, or so I have to do something. And the software, this can also create the trigger as they may also trigger an interrupt. They can have special operation called the system call or monitor call. This is how the timeline of interrupt operation goes. See, this is input output devices. When input output operate comes or some device needs the input output, then this starts. This is the transferring. When the transfer is done, it again goes to the idle position. Same is CPU. It does some work, then it becomes idle. It does some work, then it becomes idle. Our task is to maximize this. And we have certain predefined number of interrupts. So we have a table of pointer. We have interrupt routines just in order to increase the speed. And this table of interrupt pointers is stored in the low memory. That is the main memory. And this location keeps the address of the interrupt service routine, because every device have their own interrupt service routine. So we have an array or interrupt vector which is indexed by unique device number. So you know which device has created one interrupt, right? So this gives you the address of the interrupt service routine for the particular interrupting device. Now the CPU and this device controller, they are connected to shared memory. They have a common bus, and the CPU and device controller, they can execute concurrently. They may compete for the memory cycles also. A memory controller is also there, which will synchronize the access to the memory. As we have seen, the bootstrap program, this is a simple initial program that runs the computer when it is powered up, and then it will control the transfer or control or transfer the next step to the operating system. So modern operating system, they are all interrupt driven, right? If something OS has to know, an interrupt has to come. So even they are almost always signaled by an interrupt or a trap. So hardware interrupts and software interrupts, there are two type of interrupts. Hardware interrupts, they usually occur by sending signal to the CPU, and software signal usually occur by executing a system call. What is a trap? This is a software generated interrupt which is caught by if some program has some error or a request. They want the attention of operating system, that we want your attention and we are in some trouble, please solve it. Then we have storage structure. See, the general purpose computer, they run their program from random access memory. This is also called as a main memory. So this main memory is implemented using DRAM, mostly dynamic random access memory technology. And when there is an interaction between memory, there is a sequence of instruction load and store, because they have specific memory addresses. Loading and storing is going on. So what is loading? Load instruction, this moves a word from main memory to internal register of the CPU, while store instruction move content of register now back to the memory, right? And what CPU does? CPU automatically load instruction from main memory to the for what execution it has to done. Now instruction execution cycle, if you are aware of the von Neumann architecture, first the instruction are fetched from memory, and they are stored in the instruction register. Instruction register, once they are stored, they are decoded. Means the instructions are decoded to find out that what are the operands, which internal register it needs to be stored. And after the instructions or the operand have done their work, the result has to be stored back into the memory also. So the memory unit only sees memory addresses. It doesn't know how they are generated, where they are generated. So it is just interested in the sequence of memory addresses which is generated by the running program. So what we want everything to be stored in main memory, which is not possible. Why? Because main memory is small. You start with the processor, then you have cache, then you have main memory, then you have other memory also. So main memory is very small, and it doesn't store the data permanently. It is volatile in nature. When the power is turned off, the data will be lost. Therefore, we need a secondary memory also. That is this secondary storage, which is the extension of main memory. So the main requirement of this secondary storage is what? We want to hold the large quantities of data, and that too not in volatile nature, but in non-volatile. It should be kept there. So there are magnetic disks. You know, we have SSDs also. So the devices which are coming up in the current laptops and computers, these are solid state devices. So these all devices, you know, they are depending on the size, cost, size, volatility, they are used. So let me show you the hierarchy of the storage. First of all, register is the basic, you know, 1 bit is 0, 1. You combine, say, 8 bit, it becomes a byte. You combine bytes, it becomes a register. Then you have cache, memory, main memory, then electronic disk, then magnetic disk, then optical disk, and you can even go to the magnetic tapes. Then we have cache. Cache is nothing but there is a principle that if something is there in cache, means if CPU is there and your main memory is there, then if something is there in cache, first listen to it, first take the content from the cache. Because cache is very, very low level memory, it is very close to CPU. If some cache miss has occurred, then the content can be taken from main memory, right? So this is faster. Information is cached. So these are the movement between levels of storage hierarchy, and this can be explicit or implicit. For example, we have registers, cache, main memory, disk storage, and these are all the points you need to just see, because as the by the time you may be seeing or observing this, this might have changed a little bit. So these are the it will give you a rough idea of what is the size of the register. We can say what is the bandwidth of the cache, and who is the backing, like this storage is backed by the further one, like the tapes. Now, input output structure. Each device controller is in charge of some specific device. For example, SCSI, you take small computer system interface. This can have several more devices attached to it. So what is device controller? It is maintaining the buffer storage and set of special purpose register. So it is moving the data between the peripheral and its buffer storage. So what are these input output interrupts also? If you start an input output operation, the CPU is going to load the appropriate register in the device controller. Now this device controller is going to see or examine the content of register, that what action I have to take. So once the transfer data is complete, the device controller informs the CPU that, okay, it is finished. How? By giving an interrupt. So the synchronous I/O, we have synchronous I/O, we have asynchronous I/O, input output. So synchronous I/O, the control is returned to the user process at input output completion. That is, to wait for I/O completion, some machines, they have wait instruction and they go on and on like this loop. Loop, jump, loop. It just goes on and on. So the advantage of synchronous input output is the OS knows which type device is interrupting. But there are disadvantages also. There is no concurrent input output operation for many devices. And there is no overlapping. You know, you need to have overlap so that the parallelism can be achieved. Now we have asynchronous input output also. Here the control is returned to the user processor without even waiting for I/O to complete. So we have a device status table. This table is used to keep track of all the input output devices, and each table entry shows the device type, address and state. So if other processes requires or request a busy device, the OS has to maintain a queue, and when some interrupt occurs, the OS will determine which input output device has actually caused the interrupt, and then it indexes the table to determine the status of the device, and then it will modify. And the basic advantage of this asynchronous input output is the increased system efficiency. DMA structure is very simple. See, if you have I/O, then every time you have to go to CPU, then you go to memory. I/O is this, DMA is doing simple thing. Why to go to CPU? Why not to directly go to memory? So we have a DMA controller which does that, right? I hope you got the idea. This is the basic. We are going to talk about DMA a lot. Then we have computer system architecture. We can have single processor system. You can just have single processor system. So there is one main CPU capable of executing general purpose instruction, say instruction from user processes also. Then we can have multiprocessor system. So we have multiprocessor system, and they all share the common bus, the clock, the memory, the peripherals. So the advantage of this systems are the increased throughput. So because we have more processor, they can get your work done in less time. Then you can scale, you save money because peripheral storage and power, they are shared. The reliability is good. One falls, other may work, and because the halting of system will be not there. There will be graceful degradation. See, if you have three processors, one goes down, two are still there. If two goes down, one is still there. Then we also have a tandem system. What is tandem system? We have a primary and a backup. These are two identical processors and they are connected by a bus. So two copies of every processor, of every process. The state of information, because every process has a state. It has basically PCB, process control block and table also. So the state information of each job is copied to the backup at fixed checkpoints. If some failure occurs here, the backup copy is activated. This backup copy is activated and it is restarted from the recent checkpoint. So quite expensive, but you know, always work. Then we have SMP and ASMP, symmetric multiprocessing and asymmetric multiprocessing. SMP is what? This is used by most common multiprocessor system, multiple processor system, I must say. So each processor runs an identical copy of the OS. And these copies, they communicate with each other as needed. And the processes and resources, they are shared dynamically among these processors. What is the advantage of SMP? Many processes can run simultaneously without even causing the performance deterioration. But there is a disadvantage also of this symmetric multiprocessing. Since these CPUs are separate, you know, if one may be idle, other may be overloaded, so it can result in inefficiencies also. How about ASMP or asymmetric multiprocessing? Now, each processor is assigned a very specific task. There is a master. There is a master which controls the system, and the others, they either look for the master for instruction or they have their own task. So there is a master-slave relationship in asymmetric multiprocessing. The master process schedules, it will schedule, this master will schedule, and this will allocate the work to the slave processor. And as the processor become less expensive and more powerful, this extra OS functions, they are offloaded to now the slave process. These are called the back-end processes. Okay. Then we have cluster systems. Multiple CPU on one or two individual systems, they are coupled together. This is one system, this is one system, this has some CPU, this has some CPU. Now they are coupled together. So this clustering is usually, why they are done? Because just we want high availability. So there is a layer of cluster software running between these various nodes, and each node can monitor the other. It can monitor this. So if the monitor machine somehow fails, the monitoring can take over easily. So in asymmetric clustering, there can be asymmetric clustering and various type of clustering. In asymmetric clustering, we have a hot standby host machine, and there is a hot standby host machine and one running the application. This hot standby host, it just monitor the active server. It will just monitor. If the server fails, the hot standby host is going to become the active server. This is asymmetric clustering. Then we have symmetric mode also. Here, two or more, they host, they run application and they now monitor each other. This is more efficient mode because, it uses all the available hardware. One is not just hot standing by. So it requires, that more than one application be run on can be available. They need more application to be run. Then we have parallel clusters. Now here, it allows multiple hosts to access same data on the shared storage. So most clusters don't allow shared access to data on disk, and we will talk about distributed file system also. This also, there needs to be some control and checking if you're talking about distributed file system. Then we'll talk about distributed log manager also. Then global clusters, this means machine could be anywhere in the world. Then we have storage also connected to network. This is the hosts are connected to the shared storage. We call as storage area network, SAN. Then we have operating system structure, multi-programming. So multi-programming, it increases the CPU utilization because the name suggests multi-programming. How? It organizes the job so that the CPU always has something to do. So now the OS kernel, this keeps job in the memory and begin to execute one by one until it has to wait for some input-output operation. But if it is waiting for this to do for some input-output operation, it will take over this. It will always have some job to work. So how to take a job, how to bring a job, if this is a memory, which job has to be brought into memory, this is the job scheduling. And now we have a job which is ready, which job has to be taken by CPU, this is the CPU scheduling. Then we have time sharing or multitasking system also. So this is just like multi-programming, but it is quite interactive. Interactive means the user can see, or the users can see and they can interact. And the time sharing means the system or the sharing is so fast, or CPU is switching to multiple jobs so frequently and so fast, the user are not able to find out that my work is not done for fraction of time. No. The job will be like that, okay, it is going on. So CPU scheduling and this multi-programming, they provide each user with small portion of time share. All the system, you know, they can be multiple users also. So what is the process? Process is nothing but a program under execution. So a program that's loaded into memory and it is executing is the process. And if you want good responses, we need some swapping in, swapping out. And there are various things we'll be talking about, like the delays and the problems, the overheads. Then we have a concept of virtual memory. What is the virtual memory? You know, we have a small memory. We cannot bring everything here. So we need to have some sort of arrangement so that this our big programs, large programs can also be brought here. So this is the virtual memory. So this time sharing system must also provide the file system. This file system resides on a collection of disks. So disk management, there has to be there. Then we have CPU scheduling, job synchronization, communication, and we have to ensure that deadlock should not be there. So this is the just introduction of what we are going to see, what we are going to cover in the later discussion. This is the Silver Sass Calvin book, Operating System, we are following. Thank you so much. Take care of yourself.